we're thankful that you stayed. We're glad that you were with us this afternoon. Hope you were here for the meal. If you were, you know it was a wonderful meal, as it always is. Every time we have an opportunity to eat together, it's not just good because of the fellowship. It's always good because of the food, too. I've been in some places where all you can say is, well, the fellowship was good. But here, the food is good, too. So that's certainly a thing to be thankful for. I know every time we have a big meal, and it's just biological. You can't help it. You have this feel like you need to just lay down and take a nap. Well, there's plenty of space for you to do that, but let's try to resist the impulse unless you're, you know, this tall. If you're this tall or under, you can ride the ride and you can sleep. The rest of us are going to do our best. I won't keep you too long this afternoon, but I do want to open the Bible with you. And do like we did this morning, we're going to consider one of the beautiful Psalms that's found in our Bibles. We studied Psalm 23 this morning. We're going to be looking at Psalm 117 this afternoon, so open your Bibles there. Nestled there in between Psalm 116 and 118, you can't miss it, Psalm 117. And with your permission, I want to read this psalm in its entirety. I'd like to look at the text. If we're going to study a text in particular, I always like to read it first, get all of our ducks in a row. So if you'll permit me, we're going to read the whole chapter, okay? Psalm 117. Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye people. For his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever. Praise ye the Lord. That's it. That's all there is to it. It's just two verses. It's not complicated. It's not hard. It's the shortest psalm in the book of Psalms. It's the shortest chapter in the Bible, Old and New Testament combined. It's, in fact, it is the exact middle chapter of the Bible. There are 1,189 chapters in the English Bible. 594 occur before this psalm. 594 happen after the psalm. And this psalm is smack dab in the middle. Now, of course, I say that, I call it the shortest chapter, I call it the middle chapter. The Psalms aren't actually divided into chapters. We say that sometimes, Psalm chapter 23, Psalm chapter 117 this afternoon, but really they're not chapters in a book that each tell a larger story. Each psalm is its own self-contained bit of poetry, a bit of Hebrew poetry. And so we, to be more technically, you just call it the 23rd Psalm, or Psalm 117, something like that. You don't need to say chapter when it comes to the Psalms. But the point is that each Psalm has its own particular purpose. It's there to tell its own individual story. Some Psalms are contemplative. Some Psalms are almost frustrated with the enemies of God's people. Some Psalms are penitent, like Psalm 51, where David is offering a prayer of forgiveness, or asking for forgiveness due to his various sins involving Bathsheba. But this psalm is a praise psalm. It's called a halal psalm. I'll come back to that word halal in a moment, but it means it's a psalm designed to praise. To be more particular, in fact, this psalm isn't necessarily about praising God. This psalm is where the writer, David, encourages everyone else to join him in praising God. So this is very much a psalm that's about one of the two key words in this text, the word praise. The other key word is the word Lord, which we'll talk about in a moment. So you have a psalm, you have a text. It's just two statements, essentially. Two verses, but really just two statements. Where David is trying to tell us that we have many reasons. He says it in just two sentences. We have many reasons to lift up our voices and honor the King, God himself. And I want to examine that idea in four short ways with you this afternoon. First, we're going to look at the two key words, the word praise and the word Lord. And then we're going to notice to whom those words are directed. After that, we'll consider the question why, and then close by considering the question what. All right? First of all, let's notice the two key words. One happens, both of them actually occur in the beginning. There's a time they occur in the middle, and they both occur at the end of this text. The first word is the word praise. That's the English word, praise. In Hebrew, the word for praise is halal. Now, the word halal has a very fascinating history behind it. It's fascinating to me, and it may be boring to you, but to me it's fascinating. If you look up the history of the word halal means to be bold. In fact, to be technical, the word halal actually means to be clear, as though you were, like if we would say today, let me clarify, let me be clear, let me make sure you understand what I'm saying. I want to draw attention to something. I want to put the focus on something. That's the word originally used as halal. It eventually came to be the word that means to worship and to praise, but its origin is to make obvious, to make vivid, to make bold, to shine a spotlight on, to make clear. So it strikes me as a curious thing. Why would a word that means that eventually come to mean this over there? So I think I have it understood. I think I can figure it out. Hopefully I can convey what's going on in my crazy mind the way I understand it. It came later to be used to mean celebrate or to worship. But at first it meant to put a spotlight on. So think of it in religious or godly circumstances. If I'm going to praise anybody, like if my son does well in school and I want to say something to praise him, what would you say to your child? You would say, good job. You would say, great. You'd say, honey, did you hear what happened? In other words, you would say words that would put a spotlight on that person. You would say words that would hold that person up. Look what this person did. Look how good this is. Everyone, look at this person. You wouldn't do that about yourself. That would not be praise. That would be pride. It's praise for I, pride. This is praise, pride for another. Look at what this person has done. And look how wonderful this person is and for all the things they've accomplished. Well, if you put that in religious circumstance, it makes sense. Look at all that God has done. Look at all that God has blessed you with. Look at all the good that God has done. Look at all the things that God has done. All of that, what are you doing? You are putting a spotlight on not yourself, but on the Father. You are putting a spotlight on God. You are making it clear, making it obvious to all around you that God is worthy of that kind of attention. You're not worthy of it, so you don't give it to yourself. God is worthy, so you give it to Him. So the word halal, that's what that means, to magnify, to make vivid or bold, to stand out. And that's what you do about someone else. In this case, you do it about God. So that's the first keyword. Appears at the beginning, middle, and end. The other time, or the other word that appears the same way, is the word Lord. Now, depending on if you're reading your Old or your New Testament, you're going to have a different meaning for the word Lord. In the New Testament, the word Lord, L-O-R-D, is a generic term. It can mean specifically God. You know, we pray to the Lord, dear Lord, as we say our prayers. But it also can just mean someone who is more important than me, someone who's a higher rank than me. The way we would say sir or ma'am is the way the New Testament often uses the word Lord. In fact, most famously, perhaps, is Saul of Tarsus. When Jesus appears to him, Jesus is the Lord, divine Lord, but he was also just a figure of more importance than Saul, because when he picked him up his horse, before Saul even knew he was talking to Christ, how does he refer to him? He says, who art thou, Lord? Who are you, sir? He's giving him respect because he just knocked him off his horse. That's what the word means in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, the word is often translated in a different way, or it's translated as Lord, but it comes from a different idea. In the Old Testament, it's almost exclusively referring to deity. So it's exclusively referring to God. And you'll often find it in some Bibles where it's in all caps, L-O-R-D, to make it extra clear that it's in reference to deity. This Lord, and if it's translated as Lord and it's in all caps, if you were to look it up in the Hebrew, it would be the word Y-H-W-H or Yahweh or Jehovah, depending on how you pronounce that. It's the national name of God. It's the name that God said, here is my name as you know it. All the other nations have all their gods, and all their gods have names, so they can call on those gods and call on those names to help them. Here is my name. My name is Jehovah. But then God says, but you're not allowed to say that name. My name is unpronounceable, to be technical. It's Y-H-W-H. It's a vowelless word. You're not supposed to say that name. It is forbidden for you to speak it. He does that to say, look how different it is in terms of my relationship with you versus other nations' relationship with their gods. Their gods are small. Their gods are made by their priests. Their priests carve them out of stone or carve them out of clay, and they give them a name and they call them that. I have my name. I'm giving you my name. But it's so holy because I'm so holy, you're not even allowed to speak it. David says, give that unspeakable, uncomprehendable being your praise. Praise the Lord. Halal Jehovah. Halal Jehovah. Hallelujah is the meaning of the word. See, hallelujah, it only appears a few times in your Bible, the word hallelujah, and only in the Old Testament. I think a couple times in the New Testament, but it means something else. But the word hallelujah only appears a few times in the Old Testament. It's in two words, halal Jehovah. Halal, praise the Lord. That's what the word means, hallelujah. In English, it's one word. In the Hebrew, it was two. So those are the key words. That's what this text is trying to convey. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, second point. Who's supposed to praise the Lord? David says in the text, everyone is supposed to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise the Lord, all ye people. Now, you might read that and think, but this is the Old Testament, right? Right. But God is the God of Israel, right? Right. But David is writing as an Israelite to Israelites. Yeah, that's true. Well, God is Israel's God, so why is David saying all nations praise the Lord? Shouldn't he say his nation should praise the Lord? Well, they should. They didn't often, but they should have. But David doesn't say that. He says all nations praise the Lord. I think perhaps we have the idea wrongly that in the Old Testament times that God did not care about the other nations, that he was just the Jews' God or something like that. But remember, as we read here, God was David's God, and David was not a Jew. David was an Israelite. The Jews came during the captivity in the 600s. And before he was David's God, he was Abraham's God. Abraham was a Hebrew, but he was not an Israelite because it was his grandson who became Israel. He was a Hebrew, not an Israelite. Before he was Abraham's God, he was Noah's God. Noah was a Gentile, a patriarch of Mesopotamia, but he was not a Hebrew. He has been the people, he has been the God of faithful people throughout history. It's just how he defines his people may change over the years, but the one thing that doesn't change is, are you faithful? If you're faithful to God, then you are his people. And if you are faithful to God, you can come from any nation. You can belong to any people. And if you are, then David says, praise the Lord. Remember when Jonah went eventually to preach to Nineveh. In the book of Jonah, he preached to Gentiles, Ninevites from Assyria, and he convinced them eventually to repent and pray and ask God to forgive them. And when he did, or when they did repent, to whom did they repent? They didn't repent to their Assyrian gods, they repented to God, and they praised the Lord, those nations. That's what David is conveying here. All of us are indebted to God. All of us owe God our lives, and all of us owe God the opportunity to be saved. And so all of us, all peoples, should be praising the Lord. As the song goes, of one the Lord made the human race. Through one has come the fall. And where sin has gone, must go his grace. The gospel is for all. That's the opening line of that hymn. From one the Lord made the race. That's Adam. Through one has come the fall. That's Adam, according to Romans 5. Where sin has gone, that's the world. Must go his grace. That's the world. Must go everywhere. The gospel is for all. Can you find a place on earth that is not touched by sin? I've asked that question before, and I've had someone say, well, the church. But I appreciate the sentiment, but that's not a correct statement. I am in the church, but I have been affected by sin. I'm not a sinner anymore. Sin has been washed away. But sin has affected my life because I once was a sinner. Sin is the reason why I need the church in the first place, why I need the salvation of Jesus Christ. So, yes, sin is... The church has been affected by sin because all of us who are in the church are people who escape from sin. So sin is definitely in the equation. So when you say the church, what do you mean? Do you mean the people? Because I'm one of them and I've been affected by it. Maybe you mean the building. Someone says, well, the church building is the haven away from sin. No, because hey, is everyone here perfect? I don't think so. We strive for it. We work for it. We're nearly there, but we're not there. We make mistakes. We speak out of turn. Think evil thoughts, we raise our voices. None of us is perfect, all right? The church building is not a place where you can get away from sinners. In fact, the church building, the place where we go to worship, should be a place where you invite sinners. We should be opening our doors to sinners. So no, don't say that. That fosters an attitude of we're a sinner's not allowed club. That's certainly not accurate. When you say the church is a place free from sin, do you mean the spiritual body of Christ? That's a true statement. But I asked the question was, where in the world can you find a place free from sin? The church is a heavenly kingdom, not a worldly one. No, where sin has gone is everywhere. You cannot set foot anywhere on this earth and find a place where sin and temptation to sin is not present. It's everywhere. Therefore, God's grace must go everywhere. Who takes God's grace everywhere? I do. Who takes God's grace, which is found in this book, everywhere? The people who preach this book. Not preachers like my profession preachers. Christians who proclaim the Word of God. We must take the gospel out and help people. We must give people the opportunity to praise the Lord, all nations, all people, because the gospel is for all. So we've seen the two key words, praise the Lord. We've seen to whom they're directed, all people, all nations. Now let's answer a couple of quick questions. First of all, why do we praise the Lord? I mean, you'll not find a sermon, you'll not find an opportunity for us to get together where we don't say, let's stand and sing. Or let's pray. Well, all we're saying is, let's engage in worship. Let's do something to lift up God. Well, why? Why are we saying that? Why do we praise God? David tells you in Psalm 117, verse 2, we do so because of his kindness, and we do so because of his truth. Aren't you glad that God is God? And because he's God, he is a kind God. Now just think for a moment what your kind of life you would have if you had some other God as your God. Imagine if Zeus from Greek mythology was your God. Zeus, who according to history or Greek mythology history, was vindictive, petty, and a rapist monster. He mated with everything, cheated on his wife Hera constantly. It didn't matter if you were a god, a goddess, a Greek, or an animal. Zeus was going to lay eyes on you, and if he did, look out. He was vindictive and petty. Have you heard the story of Prometheus? Prometheus, the Greek god who brought fire to the world. I mean, essentially, he brought the first technology to the world. And because Zeus was so angry that he did something nice for humanity, Zeus chains him to a rock in the middle of the ocean and sends birds to come and pluck out his liver. Now you think, well, I mean, how many livers does a guy have? Eventually it'll go away. No, because Zeus put a spell on him to make his liver constantly regrow so the pain wouldn't be never-ending. That's vindictive. That's petty. That's crazy, right? Who would think of something like, why the liver? Who would think of something like that? And then there's Zeus's dad. Yes, Zeus had a father. His name was Cronus the Titan. He was nuts. He once heard a prophecy that said one of his children, who would be Zeus, would rise up to overthrow him. So what does he do? You probably think, well, he killed his children. Yeah, he ate his children. That's how crazy he was. The only reason that Zeus escaped was because his mother hid him in another place and replaced him with a bag of rocks dressed up like Zeus. And he ate the rocks. Didn't even notice. It's insane. And before that, Cronus killed his father, Uranus. Which, I know that sounds like a bad joke, but that's true. That was his name. And he killed him. And before he killed him, he castrated him. That's how crazy Greek mythology is. Aren't you glad the Greek gods are not your God? God, the God of the Bible, the one true and living God, is a kind God. He is a merciful God. He is a forgiving God. Prometheus begged for forgiveness and found none. God will forgive you. His kindness is self-evident. His kindness is understood. You don't even need to explain it. It's so obvious, but still I'll explain it. Salvation, there, that explains it. You want to know how kind God is? He offers you salvation when you don't deserve it. But that raises the question, why does man need salvation? If his kindness is understood in the fact that he gives salvation, it makes me want to say, well, why do I need salvation? I need salvation because if I don't have it, I sin and I'm punished with hell. Someone might hear that and say, well, then he's not very kind. If he's punishing me with hell, he's like Zeus punishing Prometheus. But you missed the point. Hell is not a matter of kindness or meanness. Hell is a matter of presence. Hell is a place where God is not. He removed himself from hell because the devil and his angels chose not to be with God. So God said, well, you can just go over there in the corner then, and I won't be there. And if I choose not to serve God, if I choose to serve Satan, it's not a matter of God being kind or mean. It's a matter of God saying, if you don't want to be with me, then don't be with me. Here's a place where you can be where I'm not. And that place is called hell. It's not a matter of God being mean. You want to talk about God's kindness. In fact, if you want to do it right, you don't start with salvation. If you want to talk about God's kindness, start with Eden. God made man and placed him in a paradise. Placed him in a garden paradise to walk and talk with him forever. Man blew it. Man ruined it. Man messed things up for himself. God was kind to us. We repaid his kindness with our obedience, with ingratitude, with disobedience. And in response, what did he do? He sent his son to die for us. Yeah, call him mean. That's a very incorrect statement. Praise the Lord, because he is so kind. But still, someone will persist and say, hell is not just, you know, a dark closet in the corner somewhere. Hell is a place where there's eternal fire that rages forever. That's not kind, someone will say. But that takes us to our other word. Praise the Lord, not just for his kindness. Praise him for his truth. If you think of truth, I want you to think of fairness. Think of what is right. Something that is true is something that is right. Truth means what is right will be done. If I play by the rules, then in the world, if I play by the rules in the world, I might still get punished. If I don't play by the rules in the world, I might get rewarded. And if you don't believe that, you haven't been following politics. But I'm not going to talk about that. It doesn't matter. Regularly do people in the world have to cry out, it's not fair. That's an expression that should not have to be ever uttered, but it's uttered all the time. It's not fair. This is happening, and that's happening, and this is happening to me. And they're wicked, and I'm not wicked. And yet I'm suffering, and they're not suffering. It's not fair. And you're right. It's not fair. It's worldly. But that's the world that we live in. And the world is not of God. And the things of the world are not of God. But once you have God in the mix, what is fair will eventually come to pass. What is right will eventually be done at judgment. If we play by God's rules, we will get rewarded. The world may punish us. The world may kick us in the curb and kick us again when we're down. My enemies may attack us, or our enemies may hurt us or even kill us. But judgment will come. And when judgment comes, the wrongs will be made right. All the false doers will see what is true. And truth is what is right in God's eyes. David says, praise God for that. His kindness and truth. Because right now the scales are tipped against us. But one day they'll be set right. And those who are faithful will be blessed. So we looked at the words. We looked at the who. We looked at the why. Let's close by looking at the what again. What do? David reiterates. He restates the opening statement at the end of the song. Praise the Lord. That's what you do. What do? Praise the Lord. If you ever have a situation where you say, what should I do? What you should do is you should praise the Lord. Now, sometimes you got to get more specific. Sometimes there's something in particular you have to do. Should I turn left? Do I turn right? Well, you have to decide. But first thing you want to do is praise the Lord. The first thing you should do is direct your thought, direct your mind, direct your heart and your prayers to God. Lord, I have a left and a right. I don't know where to turn. But I'm thankful that I have you to guide me. And even if I turn the wrong way, I'm thankful I have your word to tell me that I've gone the wrong way so I can turn around. Because eventually I'll find the right way with you as my guide, as we talked about this morning. So the first thing you should do, the only thing you should ever do always before you do anything, is praise the Lord. That's how this psalm begins. That's how this psalm ends. It ends as a command. You praise the Lord. You. Do you love the Lord? Praise the Lord. Do you have the Lord? Praise the Lord. Have you been blessed by the Lord? Praise the Lord. He's commanding you. Praise the Lord. Praise Him in prayer. Praise Him in thought. Praise Him in word. Praise Him in song. Praise Him in life, action. Just praise Him. It ends also with an obligation. You're obligated to praise the Lord. I am not just His creation. I am not just His child. I am also His servant. And as a servant of God, I am obligated to give my due deference to He who has made me, to bow at His feet, to worship Him, to give back to Him, and to live as He would have me live. It's not just, well, I think He's nice and all, so I'll tell Him thanks every now and then. No, it's this is what I do because it's expected of me as His servant. It ends, praise the Lord, the psalm does, with a natural response. It is the natural response. When you sneeze and someone says, bless you, you say thank you. When you have something on your mouth and they hand you a napkin, you say thank you. When you drop your pencil and they pick it up, you say thank you. There are natural responses that are just common and good. When God has done so much for us, the natural response is to tell Him thank you. And the way we say thank you is to praise Him. All that He's done for us. The atheist says, I don't want anything to do with God. All right, well, quit breathing His air then. I want everything to do with God. And I'm going to live for Him. From the smallest things to the greatest things, He has done so much. Naturally, we should want to say thank you. His book has given us the way. Praise ye the Lord. So I end with a question. What is your relationship with God like today? Is your relationship with God standoffish? You go to church, maybe you say a prayer before every meal, or you try not to swear or curse at people in traffic. That's about it. That's about the extent of your being a good little Christian. That's not a relationship. If you think that's your relationship with God, that's not a relationship. Look what you've just described. You've just described a broken marriage. You only spend time with them a couple of times a week. You barely speak to them. You just try to be polite and keep the peace. That's all you're doing. That's not a marriage. That's a broken marriage. That's a recipe for divorce. And if that's what your spiritual relationship is, you are heading toward a divorce. Now, He's not going to divorce you, but you are headed to divorcing Him and becoming unfaithful to Him with the devil and his sins. A relationship with God is built on a foundation of praise. We are constantly thankful for all that He's given us and done for us. If you're not a Christian, express your thanks to God by submitting to the Christ who died for you. If you're not a faithful Christian, express your thanks to God by repenting of your sins and taking Him up on the offer He gives you to be restored back to Him and return to Him as a sheep who found His way home. Do that and find the reason to praise Him again. Can we help you this evening, this afternoon? If so, let us know how we can help you right now. It's your opportunity. Let's stand and sit here.